and welcome to the show. In one sure short move, the Narendra Modi government has gone ahead and deregulated diesel, hiked gas prices, and looked at reforms in the energy sector. We have with us the man of the moment, the Petroleum and Gas Minister, Dharmendra Pradhan. So thank you so much for talking to us. Let me first congratulate you. We've had, if you look at diesel deregulation, 19 times, you know, that 50 paise increase has happened, which has now finally led this new government to come here and bite the bullet on it. Let me congratulate you on that. They say fortune favors the brave. You've been brave and gone ahead and done that. But fortune has also favored you in terms of, you know, international crude being at the low levels that it has. Was it an easier decision because of the timing of this happening as well?
Certainly, this international price regime helped us to take this decision to link the diesel to the market forces, to the market price. Certainly, this international geopolitics, international pricing, price regime, all these factors help us to take this decision.
Right. You know, in your previous interviews, you've gone ahead and said that now the road forward, the government will be looking at how, at consumer-centric, of course, and how whatever OMCs have garnered through lower international crude prices, how is that going to be passed on to consumers, how the government is looking at a formula to do that, how soon can we expect a formula, what is the road ahead for something like this, what should consumers expect?
You see, we have a priority. When my Prime Minister Modi took charge of this country, he created a lot of hope. People of this country reposed big faith on his leadership. The previous regime was anti-poor. Previous regime messed the economic like anything. We have two challenges: how to protect the interest of poor people, how to give them relief. Simultaneously, how to put the economy on track. So Prime Minister Modi, from day one, is very focused. The issue you raise, how do we pass on the benefit to the consumer? We have done that taking the advantage of the international price regime. This is a linked thing. This is a chain. International market, Indian refinery sector, Indian downstream distribution sector. With this market link, new player will come for distribution. 10 years back, when Mr. Vajpayee was Prime Minister, there was an NDA government at that time also. Private player came to the market. When there will be a competition within the sector, some PSUs will be there, some private player will be there, some new player are given indication to come to the field. All this competition, internal competition in domestic market, ultimately benefit consumer. Taking advantage of international price, taking advantage of the refinery margin, taking advantage of their own management skills, own resource, ultimate point, end user is going to benefit, that is common man of this country. This is our categorical strategy to dealing the diesel.
Right, absolutely. So consumer has been, you know, the centric, looking at the consumer has been the center where, because this move has been taken.
And consumer is the king.
Absolutely. And as you said, that many verticals were looked at, which all came together for the deregulation of diesel to take place. But like going ahead in the next couple of months, like you've said, that the government is working on a formula to pass on the benefits that the OMCs have garnered because of international prices. How is that going, sir, at this point in time? The discussions are at a advanced stage. If you could explain to us what the thinking right now is.
You see, you have to look here, OMCs, primarily today where we are talking about OMC, these are all PSUs, all government controlled companies. With great difficulties, since after independence, these companies are taking care of need of this country. We are aspiring to be a double-digit economy. We have some responsibility. My country is not uniform economically. If you take some indicators, infrastructure, purchasing capacity, geographical terrain, all are different from different, there are vast difference in different part of the country, in this country.
Right.
So, OMCs are the agency to take the, they are doing business, simultaneously they are doing social, they are fulfilling the social need of the country.
No, absolutely.
They have that dual responsibility.
You have to keep their interest in mind as well.
They have dual responsibility.
Right.
So profit margin is very low. Simultaneously, we are exposing them to competition.
Right.
How do we pass on the benefit? It's through competition. When there will be competition from private player also. Some private player also doing refinery business in this country. They are also, they had also already in the market.
Yes.
They are now re-enter the market. Some new player will come. Through competition, we want to pass on as much as benefit to consumer.
Right.
Whether it is government-centric PSU, government-controlled PSU, government-run PSU, or private sector.
Would it be right to conclude then, sir, that at this point in time, as you rightly mentioned, OMCs, have a very small profit margin. And so at this point in time, it is status quo as it goes, as far as because of international crude prices is concerned?
Already on diesel, they have reduced 3 rupees per liter.
Right.
What do you think that? That's
right.
The passion of the benefit to the consumer.
Right.
What else you can expect?
Right.
It will be now market-linked. As and when they will get some elbow room, they will pass on it to consumer.
All right. This brings me to my next question. You mentioned competition. Private. Are you excited about the competition coming in into the sector, in the retail space especially? You had, private players which were awaiting this for a really, really long time. Are you excited? Give us a glimpse of how you feel the retail segment is going to change in the coming years.
When there will be more player, there will be more competition, more skill, more management strategy. Who is going to benefit out of all such things? It's common man. It's
right.
The consumer. So all this policy will lead to greater empowerment, greater option in front of consumer.
Right.
Those who will give better facility, better service, better benefits, they will offer that service. So ultimately, consumer is the king.
Right. Another consumer-centric question, and of course, let me phrase it this way. Diesel delinking has happened. Now it's all going to be according to the global prices and indicators as it moves. Going ahead, today it looks good, of course, because international crude is low. Tomorrow, when prices will rise, as we've seen, the country will just have to deal with it at that point in time. Like we've seen, petrol, of course, has been deregulated as well. So as far as diesel is concerned, my question to you is it going to be a complete hands-off approach now from the government?
You see, we have taken a very well thought before taking this decision, coming to this point, there is a bigger consultancy within the government. We have committed to certain philosophy also. Our primary concern is how to create a robust economy in this country, how to put the economy on track, how to create a confidence among the investor, how to create a confidence among the financial institutions. There are some prerequisites to create that confidence. What is the outcome of this robust economy? If my country's economy will be self-sufficient, robust, and my market will be run through my condition. Out of this kind of synthesis, who is going to be have the fruit? It's the common man of this country. We cannot have both the things.
Definitely.
So my strategy is very clear. I want to create a good business atmosphere. My Prime Minister, my Finance Minister, very clear, very categorical. We want to create a transparent and confident business model in this country. Market linking of diesel is a well-thought decision. We have also concern about my consumer section. Price is an issue. I think it's a well-thought decision. We have taken a risk. I think we have to carry forward it.
Very interesting. So the sense that I'm getting from you in the government, the highest levels, is that there is confidence in the government that the economy of the country is at such a stage that it can, it's a well thought out risk at this point in time. It can withstand any issues in the global prices that come international prices that come in the future. Am I right? Is that the thinking right
now?
I
think you are in the right track.
On to gas was the other big move, hiking of gas price. Again, a well thought out decision, even though in April the previous government was ready with it, the election commission came and said they couldn't. When the new government came in, they put a committee in place, there was a proper deliberation on it. And of course, the industry has applauded that finally there is a hike which has come in, which was awaited for a really long time. But there are submissions in the lead up to it where the industry has said that that it should have been higher. They were, of course, the Rang Rajan formulas were, of course, 8 and more. There have been submissions from the industry who's looking at least a larger hike coming in. My question to you is that do you think with this gas price hike, there's enough, this will spur the players to go ahead and explore more? Is that enough, that this gas price coming in?
Let me answer your question in a different way. I think this decision has enough flair to explore the last molecule of this hydrocarbon sector.
All right.
Since last 3 days, up to Bloomberg, I'm very enthusiastic after observing all your reactions. You know market better than me. There is a positive sign in the market. There is a positive sign among the investors. There is a great confidence among the. Finally, what is the outcome of this? Again, I'm telling, what is the outcome? Who is the end product of this economy? It's common man. Anything you have to do, it has to create a confidence among the common man of this country. With this decision, with this new gas pricing formula, we have created a confidence within the community, within the society. Simultaneously, we have given a very positive signal. Rightly, you mentioned 33% increase in the gas price. What they have done, that is a history, that is a past. I don't want to get into that mess. My government, Prime Minister Modi's government, very categorically come out with a transparent, future-looking, forward-looking, investment-friendly, pro-people formula. I think market has accepted that formula very enthusiastically. All the economic indicators are high on this sector since after a long time. So I'm hopeful when investors are happy, when common man is confident, this sector is going to attract much more bigger oil majors on exploration on hydrocarbon sector.
There's a 6 months revision that is in place as well. The industry is looking at it from a hopeful point of view. The markets think, as you rightly mentioned, have given it a thumbs up as well. My question to you is, why the 6 month revision? I would like to understand the philosophy behind keeping that 6 month revision. What was the committee thinking of? What was the government thinking about the forward looking revision of 6 months? Are we looking at maybe a slower rise in gas price hike? What is the philosophy really behind that?
Maybe reduction gas price. Why do you always think it
should
be?
Sure, that could be. Increased? Fair enough. Sure.
Sometime it may be reduced.
Absolutely.
According to the need of the market, according to the availability, augmentation of the gas fields, these all are both either way. Let me explain you in this way. What was the previous formula? Previous formula, gas price should be revised after 4 years, after 5 years. When they decided around 2009, they put a condition after 5 years, around 2014, there will be revision. That creates an occasion to review the relook the gas price from 12-13. They have started deliberation. Mr. Rangarajan recommended for monthly revision. Previous government, when they fixed the price at a higher point, around $10, $9.45 in NCB, they put a condition of 3 month revision. Talking after lot of segment, the producer, the stakeholder, the investor, the bankers, we at government took a considered decision. It has to give a assurance. It has to give a, we have to end the ad hoc aging. We have to minimize our governance in this sector. So there will be a well-laid formula. It will link up to the market. It may little bit go. It may little bit decline also. It will, how do you revise that? Monthly is too early. Quarterly is in the same pace. 4 years is too long. 5 years is too long. So let it be 6 months. Let's start. Let we see how things are coming up.
Right. So that was the thinking behind
to stabilize the market, to stabilize, to reassure the investment.
You need at least 6 months for that to happen. Let me ask you, you know, in terms of there are certain gas fields where players have come and said that even, you know, $10 per MMBTU is not feasible. Now that you have set the gas price, and of course there's a clause that there will be a revision every 6 months, how do you see this panning out? Is there enough incentive for a lot of these players to, maybe they will let go of certain gas fields and not look at it at all? Maybe market dynamics dictate that at this point in time. How do you view that? Are we going to look at, any changes in that?
You see, we have a history in this sector. Before independence, we have also exploration fields in northeast area of this country.
Right.
And in recent past, we had a 9 round of NELP. The desirable investment should have been in this sector in India is not there. Up bearing few domestic oil majors, few international oil majors, none of the big players
went in there.
Were in the Indian market. To create that confidence, we put a clause in this new formulation. Yes, we do appreciate the difficulty of the deep water exploration and production. We appreciate the challenge of high pressure, high temperature zone. After 1st November 14, whatever the new discovery in these specific zones, if the stakeholder, if the producer, if the explorer is coming to competent authority, which is Director General Hydrocarbon of this government, with their scientific data, scientific claims, if DGH satisfied so, then they can recommend to government, yes, here is a case, what are the high temperature area, what is the deep water exploration, all these are internationally acknowledged modules and practices there. Nobody can tamper that, all those area. So with scientific analysis, with scientific endorsement, if DGH is recommending, we have to appreciate the big investment will come if their investment will be protected, if their investment will have assured return.
Definitely.
These are the some steps. So we have a clause, we'll give premium to all this difficult area. If DGH will satisfy with sufficient scientific data,
right,
then government will give them premium.
So, which brings me to my next question, the premium gas pricing, like you mentioned, that clause is in there. When can we expect it? I'm not asking you for a timeline in terms of by what date, but is it on a, war footing? When can we expect this clarity to come in?
The premium, it's already clarified. There is a clarity.
Okay.
That for market is in up mood. Market is buying it for that mood, that point. So there is a clarity. We have very categorically stated in our policy. We took a decision in a cabinet very consciously. After 1st November, any new discovery will come. If they will claim so, with this kind of condition, this kind of scientific information, competent authority GGH, then we can go for that.
Mr. Pradhan, we've seen the thinking in the government, like even as far as coal was concerned, anything which is in a legal tangle, and there was so much which was in a legal tangle as far as the infrastructure, energy sectors are concerned, the thinking in the government was let it play out, let final decisions from the courts come in, and then we will go ahead and deal with a particular thing. As far as RIL is concerned, the new gas price hike doesn't apply to them. The government has said of it is an arbitration, is continuing. How soon do you see this arbitration finishing?
You see, we have done nothing new. This is a well-laid practice in international level. When something is sub judice, something is on judicial scrutiny, that sanctity has to be there. So there is a dispute. They are a business house, we are a government.
Right.
So this kind of dispute is nothing new. There are some claim and counterclaims. There are two different point of view. Let's see. All this under the judicial scrutiny. Whenever the judicial scrutiny process will complete, I can dictate how. I am not a news anchor.
Definitely.
I didn't run a TV channel. So I can't predict what is the deadline. It's a judicial scrutiny. They will take its own time.
My
expectation will be it should be this kind of dispute should resolve as early as possible. Whatever support system I have to provide, that from the government side will cooperate and will provide.
Fair enough. That's the clarification which is coming in on there. With these big ticket reforms coming in now, do you think the whole image of India has changed for the energy sector? Do you think the big players, of course BP has been here, but do you think they will come back now? Will you look at these big international refinery players coming back in now? How are you seeing this move?
Let me answer this question in a very broader way. This is not only hydrocarbon sector. After May 2014, lot of things has changed in Indian scenario. India's image has enhanced like anything in the world scenario. There is a lot of hope within the country. There is lot of hope outside country also. Nobody can ignore the size of my market. My Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, rightly stated some days back when he unveiled the ambitious program, Come Make in India. On that occasion, he put forward an idea in front of Indian industry. Think about Indian market strategy. Lot of world investment is eager to come to India. How they will come? You have to have a transparent policy. You have to have early decision. You have to have time-bound decision. You have to have a big management scheme. All these are not mere speeches. They have to be on the table. They have to be on the field. There should be this kind of confidence has to be there for good business, for the good profit. Profit is not a bad word.
Definitely.
Rightly, my finance minister expressed 2 days back, profit is necessary for this society. Government is the trustee. Government is the organizer of entrepreneurship. Government is the coordinator of profit making. But it should be within the limit. So after Prime Minister Modi come to the scenario, the world is enthusiastic about Indian market. World is enthusiastic about Indian community. And Indian community has some inherent capacity. A great entrepreneurial society. The kind of reception Prime Minister Modi got at Japan, got at USA, got
sure.
at Brazil. The kind of
sure.
economic leadership India is getting now.
Right.
I'm confident. India is marching ahead with Prime Minister Modi.
Right. Let me just shift gear for a moment to the other behemoth that you have, ONGC. Of course, we are awaiting. Now that, you know, clarity on gas pricing has happened, all these clarifications have come through. Do you feel this is the right time to go ahead with the ONGC disinvestment? Is it still on track? Is it something that the government will be looking at in this fiscal?
It's not to coordinate by my ministry, but finance ministry is coordinating that with ONGC and with all due diligence are on the process. I think already at the government end, at the higher end, we have taken a decision. We will go for some disinvestment ONGC, some other PSUs also. In that way, the way my previous regime messed the economy of this country, we need some money for the welfare schemes, for the developmental projects. Therefore, we earn some money, we will gain some good money from ONGC, whether it is Coal India. That way, we can fulfill our commitment for the common society.
So that is on track and it will happen this fiscal.
Certainly.
You know, the third reform, of course, that was the direct benefit transfer of LNG. I know it's early days. I know it's going to be implemented by the end of the year. But what is the kind of savings in subsidy that we will be looking at from this implementation?
It's too early to quantify what will be the benefit. But everybody knows there can be substantial reduction of duplication, substantial reduction of the diversion. In that way, subsidy burden is going to be minimized, going to be lesser. That way, government can save some money from subsidy expenditure.
Right. My last question to you is, big bang reforms have happened. Going ahead, do you think this is just step one? Going ahead, do you think in the energy sector we will be seeing a lot more reforms, maybe on the kerosene front, etc., going ahead?
All the desirable reforms is necessary since long in this sector. We are on the job of all the aspect from upstream to downstream, to import bill to subsidy burden. How do we save a pie through smart administration? In this sector, we are on the job. Hope people of India has reposed faith on my leadership, on my Prime Minister. We have to. We know our responsibility. We are concerned about our responsibility. We have to fulfill that.
Right. Thank you so much, Mr. Pathan, for talking to
us. Thank you.